In this video, we'll take a look at Windows file sharing. File sharing is a service that's been around in Windows for a really long time, and it hasn't actually changed all that much in the last 20 years or so. So, in order to do this, first thing we're going to do is we're going to create a shared folder. Now, I open File Explorer and I go into the C drive, and I'm going to create a new folder. And in this case, I'll call it Accounting Files. This is a folder that I've now created, and my intent with this folder is to share it out to the accounting group, and this is for them to modify their accounting files. It's a single place where anyone on the network can jump in and connect. This server happens to be a member of a Windows 2012 R2 domain, and this server is also a member on that same domain. So what we're going to do to test this out is we'll set it up on server 1 and we'll connect to it from server 2. Now, right now it's just a folder. What we need to do to share it is to right click on it and go to properties. Now with Windows file sharing, you don't need to install any additional roles, but there are some interesting role services if you do decide to add the file and storage services roles. Now, two tabs should jump right out at you here that you will need to work with. One is the sharing tab, and this is the way that we're actually going to share the folder out to other computers. And the security tab, this is how we're going to make sure that only the accounting group is really going to be able to make changes to it. So I'm going to go into advanced sharing, and I always recommend this as the method for sharing. For one, this isn't something that has changed in the last 15 to 20 years of Windows Server. If you use the advanced sharing button, you're going to know how to share out a folder in any version of Windows Server, all the way back to Windows NT. We go into advanced sharing and we can choose to share this folder. Now the share name gets created as accounting files, and one thing that I always recommend is to take spaces out of these share names. Frankly, I probably shouldn't have had a space in the accounting files folder, but if nothing else, we should at least get rid of it out of the share name in case we ever need to do any scripting or anything else that might use space as a delimiter, meaning suddenly it sees a space and it thinks it's on to the next thing. Well, really it's all one name. It just makes things easier. The next thing we need to look at is the permissions of the share. When you share out a folder using the advanced sharing button, the default permission is everyone, read only. Now what this tells us is that the everyone group, which is all users and computers including guest, can open this share and at least read everything according to the share level permissions. I'm going to leave this as the default to show you a real common error that a lot of first-time administrators run into. So I'm going to close that and say OK. And going to security, these are the default file permissions. There's a creator owner. Whoever creates a file or a folder is going to have ownership of that, and that grants them some special permissions. There's the system account, which allows the system to access the file. There's the administrator's account, which allows anyone that's an administrator on this server to maintain and manage that particular file share, including changing permissions, which is what full control generally will give, and all of the additional permissions to modify, read, write, list the contents, etc. And then we have users, which is any user on this server, and by proxy, any user on my domain. And the users group has the ability to read and execute, list folder contents, and read. You may notice that these check marks are especially light, and what that's showing us is that these are permissions that are inherited from the level up. So the accounting files folder is gaining these permissions from the root of the C drive. These are default permissions that any folder created in there is going to get. Now that can be really helpful to us, and it can also be a bit of a burden, because for example, if I wanted to go in and remove users and remove that permission, and I go into Edit and I choose Users and I say Remove, I can't remove it because it's actually inheriting permission from the parent. Now, in Windows, it tells us exactly how to fix this, and I'll show you how to fix this. It's in this Advanced button. In here, we can disable the inheritance on that folder, meaning I don't care about inheritance anymore. I'm going to set my own permissions at this level. Now, when we choose to do this, two different choices are available to us. We can take any of those inherited permissions and turn them into explicit permissions, as if we wiped out permissions and then re-added them all exactly as they were inherited. Or I can simply remove all inherited permissions and be left with nothing. I always recommend doing this, because by doing this, if you make the wrong move, you're actually removing your own permissions. It's not impossible to get those permissions back, but it's several added steps. So I'm going to choose this one, and you'll see what happens here. Say OK. And now the users have this darkened check mark. What that means is the permissions are explicitly set at this level, and I can manipulate those, including simply removing the users and their permission entirely. Now I'm left with creator, owner, system, and the administrators. So let's test this out before we go too much further, and let's make sure that we can connect to this file share from Server 2. We can open File Explorer. There's several ways to type in a UNC path, and a UNC path, Universal Naming Convention, is a way to specify a path that tells us where that resource lives and what that resource's name is. So it's usually \\ the server name and then \ the share name. And in this case, I'm looking for \\ server 1 because that's what my server's name is. And accounting files was the name of the share, the name of the resource that I created. And when I connect to that, there's nothing yet in that folder, but this is that central repository that I'd have for my users to place their files in. Now, if I, as an administrator, wanted to go and add a new text document, I can't. And the reason is, back when we set up that default permission here on that share, if I go back to properties and sharing, the default permission is everyone gets read-only. The most restrictive of the share permissions in this sharing tab, in the security permissions in the security tab, these are the NTFS file system permissions. The most restrictive of those two permissions will win. In this case, administrators, which is the user I'm actually logged on as, the administrator account, administrators has absolutely full control over this folder and should be able to write files in, except it's limited because the most restrictive of the two permissions is this permission right here. On one hand, I can only read, and on the other hand, I had full control. So the most restrictive of the two permissions will win. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to add in administrators. Oh, let's try this maybe a slightly different way. Let's add in the permission. The reason that didn't work is because I'm looking at this from the domain perspective. So I could say something like domain admins, which is another group that is used to collect up your administrators. And I can give domain admins full control change and read at the share, and then I can remove the everyone. Now only administrators, domain admins, and local server administrators are going to be able to access this share. I can say OK to that. And now if I try to make that file again, it works. I can write data. I can change data. I can save data. I can make new files. And I can even delete old files. I'm not going to delete this one quite yet, because I do want to show you that it does really exist over here. And this is that location where that would live. If I do choose to delete it, it will be deleted from both locations. Because this is really where the file lives, this was just simply looking at the files over here. Now, I named it Accounting Files, and the purpose for that was so that I can allow the accounting users the ability to connect up and use this file share. So let's put those accounting users in here and grant them their permission. Now, there is a recommended way to do this. There's a simple way, and there's also a recommended way to do this. The simple way is I could simply give the accounting users permissions at both the share level and at the NTFS file permission level. A better way to handle it is using groups. And because I am in a domain environment, I'm going to use groups and I'm going to use the AGDLP method. Now, it's an awful acronym, but it actually is pretty memorable once you've been working with it for a while. The AGDLP acronym works like this. AGDLP stands for Accounts, Global Groups, Domain Local Groups, and Permissions. And the reason we use this is we will create user accounts and we'll add them to global groups. And we'll usually name those global groups after the collection of users. So I made an account named Bob. Bob works in accounting, and that's his user account name. I took the Bob user and added him to the accounting global group. From there, I added the accounting global group to a domain local group named Accounting Files. And now when I set up permissions, the best way to do this is to grant the Accounting Files group the permissions. This is going to self-document your network. It's going to allow your permissions to trickle down through a flow of accounts to global groups, to domain local groups, to permissions. And it builds a structure that all of your administrators can follow. And this is a Microsoft recommendation as well. It actually originated back in the days of Windows NT when we would need to use global groups to connect to other domains groups. This is a structure that's been in place for a long time, and the reason that we do this is because we didn't always have the functionality where any user can be in a group that can access any resources all over our domains and forests. So instead, we have things broken down structurally like this. So here's how we're going to do it. I have a basic Active Directory set up here. Nothing terribly out of the ordinary, and I haven't created any real significant organizational units or structure here. And for this example, I created accounting as a security group, which is global. I created Accounting Files, which is a domain local group, and I created Bob, who happens to be part of accounting. And we can see that if I go into the Bob account, he is a member of accounting as well as the domain users. If we look at accounting, this is the accounting group. Accounting has Bob in it, just Bob for now, but it could be hundreds of users. And the accounting group, so all of these users essentially would get these permissions. If we go to the Member Of tab, we'll see what groups that accounting is a member of. Accounting is a member of the Accounting Files group. And by self-documenting this, Accounting Files, it's pretty obvious where I'm using that. Accounting Files is simply used to grant permission to that Accounting Files share. So anytime I need to go in and see what all these accounting users get, I would see a list of all the permissions because I will create a domain local group for any permission I choose to give. Now, it seems like a lot of extra groups and a lot of extra work on a rather simple network. But once that network becomes complex, you're going to have a lot of time saved by using this structure. And it will, as I said, self-document your network. So, if you're following along at home, you'll know that I need to assign some permissions here for Bob to be able to access this information. What group do I add here? I should be able to add the accounting files group. And why do I add the accounting files group? Because it's the domain local groups that you use to assign permissions. And in this case, I'm given a choice. What permissions do I want to give accounting files? I'm going to let them modify files. I'm going to let them read and execute list folder contents, read and write. But I'm intentionally leaving off full control. And the reason for this is because I typically don't want my ordinary users manipulating this access control list. If they do so, they might actually wipe out some permissions inadvertently if they don't really know what they're doing. So full control is really only necessary for administrators in most cases. Now the next part, once we set this security information here, there we go. Accounting files has gained all of those permissions. And at the share level, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to make sure that accounting files has permission at the share level. And the reason is, if I left them out, the most restrictive permission, which for them would be no permission, would be the permission that wins. You need to set permissions in both places. And the best practice is to attempt to keep the permissions as close as possible. So now I've set some permissions. It's time to log in as Bob. I'm going to log out as administrator here. And I'm going to log in as Bob. These just happen to be Hyper-V virtual machines, but this could work for physical machines as well. Alright, we can open File Explorer just like we did as the administrator. We can use that same UNC path. And there's no files in there. I had already deleted the other one. But I can make a new file. When I look at this file, I can actually take a look in there and see the permissions. And as you'll see, the permissions have trickled down. Now something interesting here, the accounting files permission has been inherited, the administrator's permission has been inherited, and Bob has actually inherited full control on his file. And that's because we left creator owner as a available permission on that share. If you don't like this functionality and you don't want Bob to be able to go in and change these permissions, just wipe out that creator owner permission, and I'll show you where that is. Sometimes you might choose to do this, sometimes you might not want to. It all depends on what works best for your system and whether or not the creator and the owner of a file should get this special right. So there you have it. We've created a file share. We've used group nesting using the AGDLP strategy. And we've set security permissions, the NTFS file system permission, as well as the shared folder permission. And we've tested those out to make sure they work. And that is pretty much all there is to basic file sharing on a Windows server.